following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
She's got the news. She talks with newsmakers. She encourages us to laugh, and she cries with us. Speaking truth to power and questioning authority daily, it's the Nicole Sandler Show.
Oh, my God. There are no words. I am watching the murder trial of Derek Chauvin, the fucking piece of shit posing as a cop who killed George Floyd. Testifying right now, and I am going to bring this up for you because I don't know how we cannot listen to what's being said here, is a firefighter from Minneapolis who happened upon the scene while it was going on.
I'm going to bring this up for you.
I need to, damn it. Where is that audio coming from? Shoot. Bear with me one second, everybody, because we're hearing myself repeating. I got to mute everything. Mute. That's where it came from. Okay.
In consciousness.
Here we go.
That you saw?
No.
And you stayed with him, or I'm sorry, you were there the entire time until he was loaded into the ambulance, correct?
Correct.
She just broke down crying, a professional firefighter who told the story of not being able to help this man she saw dying, being killed, and she broke down in tears, and I broke down in tears, and you probably broke down in tears, because this is insane.
At some point, you made, well, I guess the question is this. You didn't pay close attention to Mr. Floyd at some point because you knew he was unconscious.
Needing medical attention. There was no question.
Right. No question.
And based on that, you focused more on trying to get the officers to allow you to help.
Correct.
And at some point, did you start video recording?
Yes.
And with your phone, I assume.
Yes.
Oh, she started recording too.
I'm not sure why I chose to do it. It's an instinct.
And so you did record it?
Yes, sir.
And based on that, I guess I'll just ask it this way. At some point after the incident, you were interviewed by law enforcement officers.
The BCAs?
Correct, yes.
Yes, sir.
And you made that video available to them, correct?
Correct. All
right. And why did you think it was important to record that?
Because memories of witnesses are never going to be as good as a video.
That is true.
And so you wanted to have it to preserve.
It wasn't conscious, but I'm sure that's why anybody takes a video.
Of course. I know this is the prosecutor, and he's got to ask these questions, but some of them you just want to go, duh!
Sorry, just bear with me a second while I try to read my own handwriting. After recording that video, you stopped recording at some point, correct?
I don't remember.
Okay. Well, obviously you did stop at some point, right?
Well, yeah.
And eventually the ambulance took Mr. Floyd away.
Right.
And then earlier I said we'd come back to that moment in the previous video in Exhibit 11 when you were the ambulance left and you were still standing on the sidewalk there.
Mm-hmm.
Yes?
Yes.
And we saw you just standing there. What's going through your mind as you're standing there?
I'm not sure. I think I probably was in disbelief.
And kind of in shock?
Yes.
And what's and at some point then did you also make a 911 call?
Yes.
She called the cops too. And everyone was calling the cops on the cops.
It had to be sort of, I think distressing was the word you had used before. Did you have, when you're there and you're trying to help and couldn't, did you have a feeling of helplessness?
Absolutely.
Were you upset about that?
Yes.
Did you feel that, you know, whatever the end result, you could have tried to help?
Sustained.
Well, why did you feel helpless?
Because there was a man being killed, and I would have, had I had access to a call similar to that, I would have been able to provide medical attention to the best of my abilities, and this human was denied that.
Yes, he was.
Right.
This is devastating. This has been devastating testimony. Just unbelievable.
So from that point, you know, we saw you standing there on the sidewalk, just sort of standing still.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And from there, did you stay in the area for a little while?
Yes.
And at some point, you made a 911 call?
Yes.
Why at that point did you call 911?
I think it all settled in that I wish I would have done that immediately, because it was ridiculous that Fire Station 17 was as close as it was, and that they hadn't been there. I should have called 911 immediately, but I didn't. And when things calmed down, I realized
that she should have.
I wanted them to know what was going on. I wanted to basically report it.
And so you made that call, correct?
Correct.
And a little bit more than a minute long. At some point, they wanted to transfer you to a supervisor, correct?
Correct. I asked for that.
And but then the call ends.
Okay.
Do you remember why the call ended at that point?
I don't know exactly, but there was kind of a lot going on. I was still worried about the witnesses on scene, particularly because they were people of color and black men. I was worried about their safety.
Good for her.
And there were officers still on scene.
Yeah.
But also, fire came, and it may have been that I ended the call because my coworkers were there and I could tell them what was going on.
So tell us about that. So at some point when you're there at the scene still, did a fire truck come?
Yes.
And they're coming to respond to the call.
They're coming to respond to the call, and they went into Cup Foods to actually look for a victim.
A victim? What?
Which is unique for that, there to be that much miscommunication.
You think?
Let me ask you just a little different question. So when they came, those firefighters, did you know them?
I knew two of them.
And how many total came?
Four. A driver, two firefighters, and a captain.
And so the two that you knew, how did you know them?
Crossing paths at work.
So they knew who you were?
Yes.
So you knew that members of the fire department knew you were on scene as well?
Yes.
But off duty, of course?
Yes.
And so you had a conversation with them while they were there at Cup Foods?
Yes.
And you also had some conversations with other people who had stuck around afterwards?
Yes.
And this is how testimony goes. It is like pulling teeth, but I guess they have to do this to get every detail out.
And I also spoke to them.
This woman looks really upset.
I have no further questions, Your Honor.
Okay. So, here comes the defense attorney.
You may.
I didn't hear what he...
You can just stay in a stretch of place if you'd like.
What he asked. So, okay, so they've muted the mics. Oh, I guess he's approaching the bench, the defense attorney. So this is a Minneapolis firefighter who happened upon the scene while George Floyd was being murdered by Derek Chauvin, the police, former police officer sitting at the defense table. I couldn't turn away from this. What we are hearing is devastating. If you haven't been listening today, you missed the testimony of a bunch of kids, a 9-year-old girl who was a witness to the police murdering a black man. She was a 9-year-old little black girl. She witnessed the cops, the people who are supposed to be protecting us, her, murder this man who wasn't doing anything. He was on the ground. His hands were cuffed behind his back, and Derek Chauvin had his knee on his neck. And now that you can see the video from the other side of the street, the surveillance video, you can hear, you can see that two other cops were also appeared to be on Derek Chauvin's body. I don't know if they were or not from the angle. What this firefighter said just a few minutes ago is that he had the weight of 3 grown men on him. She would have checked for a spinal cord injury because of all the weight that was on his neck and his back. All right, sounds like they are they coming back? I don't know. What? How did I? Oh, they're muted. It's not me. They're muted. All right. So I guess that they're doing a bench conference where, you know, they always do it so that here they're back now. All right. So I guess the defense attorney is going to ask a question.
Just have some follow-up questions for you. Thank you for being here with us today.
By the way, Harvey J.K. is going to join us later in the hour.
You testified that you've been a firefighter now for 2 years, approximately.
Correct.
And I see you're wearing your uniform today.
Correct.
And that would be like your dress uniform or your Class A uniform.
Correct.
And that's common to wear when you testify in court.
Correct.
Fair to say that you were not wearing your Class A or any uniform on May 25th, 2020.
Correct. I was off duty.
Right. Okay. Being a firefighter is a stressful job.
Correct.
You testified about your experience as an EMT. We didn't talk much about your firefighter training.
Okay.
So you said you went through a 4-month academy, correct?
Correct.
And in that academy, I assume you learn like the basics of fire, right?
Correct.
Like different types
this
of
this guy is grasping at straws. Whatever. Has been all day.
Right.
All day.
How to approach a fire, how to, you know, where to aim the hose, I guess.
Yes, but fire is fire.
Right. So it's but sometimes you probably got to come from the top down or from the bottom up, right?
Where is this going? If I was the other attorney, I'd say, objection. Where is this going?
Into a burning building, right?
Right.
Being safe, being cautious.
Right.
It's again, part of what you have to learn is how to deal with the stress of being a job, of being a firefighter.
Right.
Do you, in either in the academy or in your continuing training, do you have trainings that focus on how to deal with the physical reaction to stress?
We do go over that in our trainings throughout the continuing ed. Also, I think you're suited or not for the job.
Sure. Takes a certain type of person to do the job. Right.
Right?
But breathing becomes important, right?
Right.
You put on an oxygen tank, a mask.
Yep.
You've
okay.
You've got to know how to
so
breathe.
So get to your
properly.
Point, sir.
You're breathing, right.
Got
and
it.
Sometimes you may go into a situation, it's not totally.
I'd be a horrible witness because I'd say, what is your point?
To save someone's life. Again, controlling your breathing. Right.
Right.
And you learn about, have you ever heard the term tunnel vision as a part of fire training?
I'm getting more and more aggravated with this guy.
Not necessarily as a part of fire training, but I know what tunnel vision is.
So when you're stressed, you kind of focus on a particular thing.
Right.
Right? and you're kind of changing.
You know what? I can't listen to this guy anymore, because this is the defense attorney, and I guess he's trying to get her to say, oh, they had whatever, trying to get her to make excuses for Derek Chauvin for putting his knee on George Floyd's neck, causing his death. There is no excuse. I have now, look, we watched the video originally together. It was the end of May of last year. It was a day or two after this happened. And I pulled it up and we watched it together on this show. And I watched it again yesterday when they played it during the opening argument from the prosecutor, and again just a little while ago, because they basically played it again. They played it from different angles. I have seen George Floyd die a number of times. And what got me this time was the audio. Again, this is radio. Yes, we have a video component, but this is radio. And today I was doing some work, and so I wasn't watching, but I was hearing the audio. Because this is a radio show, let's hear the audio. I want you to hear. Oh, I need to mute this. All right. I want you to hear George Floyd, what he's saying while this piece of shit, sorry excuse for a police officer, has his knee on his neck and is keeping him from breathing. So when the videotape started, he was already on the ground. And you can hear him moaning, basically. Please. I can't breathe.
Please, man. Please, man. Well, you got him down, man. Let him breathe, at least, man.
This up, I can't breathe.
So you can breathe.
That's him moaning, crying.
I'm about to die this thing. Man, I can't breathe in my face. Just get up.
You can hear that he can't breathe.
I can't breathe.
No, I don't know what cop is saying this to him, but a cop is taunting him.
Get up, get in the car, man.
Get up, get in the car, man. It's not Chauvin.
I can't move.
I've been waiting the whole time. Get up, get in the car.
Mama.
Mama. This grown man is being killed, and he's calling for his mother.
Get out of the door to get in, bro. I told you, you can't win.
My knee.
You can't win, man.
I'm through.
I know you're there. Now you didn't listen.
And they're yelling at him. I don't know who that was. One of the other cops.
My neck hurts. Everything hurts. Give some water or something.
Get some water or something, please.
I can't breathe all the time. They won't kill me. They won't kill me, man.
I can't anymore. If this jury can hear that, can see this, and not convict that man of murder, it wasn't charged with first degree murder, he should have been, because now we've seen the video how many times? And I'm sorry, that was cold-blooded, cold-hearted, just, there was a blank stare coming from Chauvin while the people are imploring him, get up, let him up, let him breathe. And he doesn't. He just keeps his knee on his neck. The EMT comes up, the ambulance pulls up. And one of the EMT guys comes up and puts his hand on George Floyd's neck to feel for a pulse. From one of the other witnesses, I learned that they asked Chauvin to get up and he wouldn't. Then they went back to the rig, got the gurney out, the stretcher, and came back to get him. And that's finally when Chauvin got up. And George Floyd was unconscious. He was limp. And Chauvin just sort of pulled him across the asphalt and dumped him on the stretcher. The whole thing is reprehensible. And what's this fucker saying now? Oh, that's this. Hold on. Let me unmute. Oh, God. Let me unmute this. Sorry.
Right. Code 4 means all clear.
Safe. Yep.
Right. So in a situation where there is trouble mm-hmm. and the police are dealing with that trouble and they know they need a medical personnel to come into the scene,
yeah.
medical won't come into the scene until it is called code 4, right?
Correct.
All right. And you said in your experience you've been on numerous calls throughout the 2 years you've been a firefighter, right?
Correct.
And what would you agree that a fair number of those may have been calls that started out as call where the police responded first?
Correct.
So it's usually the police that are there first, they do some assessment, and they will call for medical.
Correct. Right?
Have you ever been called to a scene where the police didn't call you? Meaning the police were
again,
present.
Where the fuck is he going with this? I get that it's his job, and I guess his job right now is to distract from what we've all seen for the last 2 days, what we've heard for the last 2 days. This lawyer is infuriating. I'd spit in his face. You know, earlier, you know, I'm going to take this down. I'm going to play for you a different clip. This clip is from the man that you heard throughout that video. In fact, if I just cue in a little bit to the, you know, you'll hear him.
So in a
I want to get rid of this guy. Let me mute this again and bring up.
Right. Wouldn't it be reasonable?
You shush. All right. So this audio. Hold on.
Put him in a car by now.
This guy. Right. This guy.
You enjoying it. Look at you. Your body language explains it. You fucking bum.
You fucking bum. This guy's name is.
They love him.
No, I already know that, bro.
Donald Williams.
These bum ass dudes at the academy, bro. You know that's bogus right now, bro. You know it's bogus. You can't even look at me like a man because you're a bum, bro. He's not even resisting arrest right now, bro.
His nose is bleeding.
So all these people that you're hearing testified today.
Oh, you think that's cool?
Yesterday and today.
You think that's cool, though, right?
You think that's cool, all right?
Well, what's your badge number, bro?
What's your badge number, bro?
Right.
Right. All right. So, oops. So that guy, hold on 1 second.
You're a bum for
you are a bum. So that was this guy, Donald Williams, who testified at the end of the day yesterday and then again today. And I want to play for you some of his testimony from today because it was pretty devastating. I'm joining it in the middle of the testimony here.
At some point, did you make a 911 call?
That is correct. Did call the police on the police.
Right. And why did you
call the police on the police?
Because I believe I witnessed a murder.
Yeah, you did.
And so you felt a need to call the police?
Yeah, I felt the need to call the police on the police.
Now, there were police there, right?
There were police there.
Okay, why didn't you just talk to them about it?
I believe that they didn't. We just didn't have no connection. You
know, because they were killing him.
But not on a connection of a human being relationship.
Did you believe that they were involved?
Yes, totally.
And so when you made that 911 call, about how long after the ambulance left was that?
Time regulation? I don't know.
It's a matter of minutes?
Seconds. Not too long after they retreated to the other side of the street, I proceeded to call the police.
And prior to today, have you had an opportunity to listen to a recording of that 911 call?
Can you please repeat that question?
Prior to coming to court today, did we play for you a copy of that 911 call, a recording of it?
Oh, when cannot say yes or no. I cannot remember at this moment.
Well, they're going to now. And wait till you see this big tough guy who kept calling out Chauvin as he's murdering George Floyd. How this man reacts hearing that again.
Your Honor, we would ask that it be, well, we are offering it now as Exhibit 20.
20 is received.
All right. So if we can at this point, then play Exhibit 20.
May 25, 2020.
911,
what's the address of the emergency?
Officer 987 killed a citizen in front of a Chicago store. He just pretty much just killed this guy that wasn't resisting arrest.
They just pretty much just killed this guy.
The whole time, Officer 987, the man went stopped breathing. He wasn't resisting arrest or nothing. He was already in handcuffs. They pretty much just killed the dude. I don't even know if he's dead for sure, but he was not responsible when the ambulance just came and got him. And the officer that was just out here left, the one that actually just murdered the kid in front of everybody on 36th, 38th in Chicago.
Okay. Would you like to speak with the sergeant?
Yeah, like that was bogus what they just did to this man. He was unresponsive. He wasn't resisting arrest.
He's just going. Talking. Okay, just like, hold on. Let me get
the sergeant.
Yeah, and I'm sitting here talking to with another off-duty
and he's pulling out Kleenex because this made him cry. Can you imagine? Can you imagine? Imagine being the 9-year-old little girl who witnessed this and had to get on the stand today.
I have reached the city of Minneapolis to reach someone in our property crimes division.
Murderers, bro. Y'all murderers.
He's still talking to the police and telling them they're murderers.
Murderers, bro.
Murderers, bro.
Y'all niggas is murderers, bro. Minneapolis first precinct.
Hey, it's dispatch.
Yeah, man. So I want to speak to a supervisor. Okay. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, he wants to speak with a supervisor relating to 320's cause.
Is that then an accurate recording of the call you made?
That is correct.
That's an accurate calling of the call you made. An accurate recording of the call you made. Sorry. Pretty devastating. You know, you hear him throughout the tape, just all over the cops, calling them out for the murdering this man. I mean, constantly. It was here, let me go back to the audio of the...
You're a bum for that.
You're a bum. This is him. This is all him.
You getting mad. You just sitting there stopping his breathing right now.
Look at him.
He's about to go out right now, bro.
Look at him.
And that at that point when you heard that girl say he got maced, that was Chauvin. When they were yelling at him, he's not moving, he's unresponsive, Chauvin pulls a thing of mace out of his pocket to get them to back up.
Look at him.
He's not responsive right now, bro. No, bro, look at him. He's not responsive right now, bro.
Check for a pulse.
Bro, are you serious?
Check
for a pulse.
Let me see a pulse.
Is he breathing right now? Check his pulse.
Hold on, we'll have this conversation.
Check his pulse.
Okay.
Check his pulse, Tao. Check his pulse. Tao, check his pulse, bro. Bro, check his pulse, bro.
This is still that guy, Donald Williams.
Drugs, bro. What is that? What do you think that is? So you call what he doing okay?
Get back on the sidewalk.
Get back on the sidewalk.
You call what you doing? You call what he doing okay, bro?
Are you really a firefighter?
Yes, I am from Minneapolis.
Bro, you think that's okay? Check his pulse.
Check his right pulse.
Tao, check his pulse.
Get back on the
sidewalk. The man ain't moved yet, bro. The man ain't moved yet, bro.
Okay,
bro, you're a bum, bro. You're a bum, bro. You're definitely
right
a bum,
now.
Bro.
Tell me what it is. Tell me what his pulse is right now.
Check his pulse. Bro, he has
and they still won't check his pulse. He's not one.
He's off track right now.
But yeah, bro, go back in the store, bro. You don't understand.
No,
bro.
I'm the
under. Okay, that's cool. Go back in the store, bro. Go back in the store, bro. He's not fucking moving.
I see that.
Okay, so that is what was going on. At that point, George Floyd had stopped struggling and stopped, you know, crying for his mother and saying, I can't breathe. Get off of my neck. And then it was the people who were on that corner watching it, filming it. Thank God they were there. Still fighting for George Floyd's life. This is stunning. And meanwhile, this defense attorney is still questioning this firefighter.
Can you explain what Narcan generally is?
Oh my God. He's going down the drug road. Oh my fucking God.
Easily. But a lot of people on the street have a injectable.
Okay. So I'm going to turn this down again because this piece of shit defense attorney is trying to turn it to blame George Floyd for his own death, asking about Narcan, which is, of course, the thing that they give people who've overdosed on opioids. George Floyd did not overdose. George Floyd died because Derek Chauvin had his knee stuck into his neck for over 9 minutes and he killed him. And this defense attorney, this piece of shit, is, I know he's doing his job. Look, how many times have I spoken to Jack Rice about this in recent days? But that man should be ashamed of himself. Okay. So this is going on. They will wrap up when they're done with her testimony. We heard the part of it when the prosecutor was talking to her. And frankly, that's all we need to hear. I don't need to hear that defense attorney and hear him vilifying George Floyd. That's what he's trying to do. He's trying to make the victim out as the you know, the bad guy. George Floyd tried to buy a pack of cigarettes with a bad 20. You know what? They could have written a ticket. They could have written him a citation and let the courts handle it. Instead, Derek Chauvin decided he was going to be judge, jury, and in this case, executioner. And that is just not okay. I'm just livid. I'm just beside myself. I know this is going on. Yeah. So I'll tell you what we're going to do. I see. Where is he? Where's Harvey? Where is he? Hold on. I got to find his open because I know it's here somewhere. All right. Where is he? Oh, where? Okay. One more time. Hold on. I got to mute this before I do that. We'll try it again. Okay. Where is he?
Well, where is he?
Where is who?
Where is Harvey?
Harvey.
Oh, you mean Harvey J.K.
Yeah.
Yeah, huh?
Harvey.
Well, he's coming up right now on the Nicole Sandler Show.
Oh my God, Harvey J.K. Have you been watching this trial? It's just, it's horrific. I'm not hearing you. Why am I not hearing you? You're not muted, I don't think, but I don't have any audio coming from you, Harvey. and this time it is not me. You're not muted. Hold on, I'm going to try one. No, you should be there. Why do I not hear you, Harvey? Are you sure you got your volume on there and everything the way it's supposed to be?
You can hear me.
Oh,
this
now
way,
I
right?
hear you. Yeah, what'd you do?
Yeah, I was just trying to use this microphone, and one time it works because the setting's right, the next
right.
time it doesn't. So,
oh, I got
you. If you can hear me okay, I'll just put it to the side
yep,
for now.
Yep, I hear you okay. I can show you what it is. I'll show you off the air. But basically, down at the bottom, here, what the hell? Yeah. You see at the bottom, there's a little microphone icon. It's underneath, it says mute. It pushed the little arrow, and it'll tell you select a microphone. So you need to select that microphone that you've plugged in to use that. Otherwise, it's...
Give me one second.
Okay. So, you know, it's live radio, and I'd rather be talking Harvey through getting the audio working correctly than listening to this fucking defense attorney trying to justify the murder of an innocent man.
Does that work?
That works.
Great.
Yep. See? So much better. Yeah. There you go.
You're the techie. Thank you.
Yeah, no problem. Okay, so that's working. So, are you watching any of this trial? It's just horrific.
No, I honestly can't stand it. It's I thought it was an open and shut case, so but the things you've been saying, I've been listening. The things you've been saying are exactly the kinds of things. The end of the day yesterday, my wife said, "What is?" Because we were driving back from St. Louis, 500 miles, and it was on all day on CNN, and we just didn't listen. I mean, and she said, I don't know what's going on here. I mean, it should be self-evident. And I thought maybe if the cop would have been smart, he would have just pleaded, you know, something like that. But Joyce.
Yeah, no. And this defense attorney is making me furious. So you got here at the perfect time, Harvey, because I'm
see from like, when I was listening, I could tell.
Oh, my God.
Question for you, not to get you all the more riled up. So did you get knocked off of the video streams?
No, we're still on. We're on Facebook Live. We're on Twitch. We're on Periscope and Twitter. We're just knocked off of YouTube. And can I tell you why?
Yes.
Let me tell please. You why. Because Don Henley is a fucking asshole. Don Henley apparently pays, according to one article I read, 60 people to do nothing but scour the web day and night to find Eagles music or Don Henley music so that they can pull you down off of YouTube. I didn't play a Don Henley song, and believe me, I don't play Don Henley's music anymore. Used to like the guy, have pictures with him. I've interviewed him. And so believe me, that won't happen anymore. Anybody want some old Don Henley or Eagles CDs? What I should do is burn them. But they, you would think an artist makes music, he wants the music to be heard. No, he'll take you down. So what happened was a show from 2016, 5 years ago, when I was still doing 2 hours a day, back when you were on with me every other week. I ran in the middle of the show, like in the 1 hour mark, I ran the Green News Report brought to you by Brad Friedman and Desi Doyen at the Brad Blog. And at the end of their Green News Report, they play a music bumper, a bed out. And on that particular day, sure enough, it was Don Henley's Dirty Laundry. Kick them when they're up, kick them when they're down, kick them when they're up, kick them all around. And that's what it was. And for that, you know, anybody else, when I play a snippet of a song, what happens is I get a copyright ID claim or something. And so what happens is any ad revenue that I get from the bullshit ads they run on YouTube, that the publisher and the artist,
snatch?
Yes, basically. They take the revenue. Fine. I make pennies from YouTube anyway. No great loss. So do that. You don't have to issue a copyright strike. There are some, like, Van Morrison, for example, who will take down the video worldwide. They'll block it, but they still won't give you a copyright strike. Copyright strike is what gets my live streaming suspended. And if you get three of them, they kill off the channel. So I'm suspended from streaming for 90 days because Don Henley is a fucking asshole. If you don't want people to play your music, Don, stop making it.
So when did the Eagles emerge? Was that back in the 70s?
Yeah.
So, because I got to tell you, this goes way back. I'm really drawing on a memory. I'm drawing on a memory that's got to be 50 years, 45 years old.
Yeah.
I think it was an article in the Village Voice back in the 70s that talked about the Eagles as the conservatives' favorite band.
I wouldn't doubt it. I don't think Don Henley's a conservative. I don't think any of them are, to be honest with you. I mean, Don Henley's an environmental guy. You know, he's all about Walden Woods.
He was just
But you know, they worship a higher god, the money god. It's all about the dollars, and it's Irving Azoff who's their manager. And so while I hear Don Henley, this comes from him, it comes from Irving Azoff as well. And you know, I worked in music radio in Los Angeles for 15 years. An old record company friend of mine, you know, was on the thread on Facebook saying, "What the fuck?" She said, "Call Irving." I said, "He won't remember me." She said, "Oh, yes, he would." But I've been out of music radio for 20 years. So he doesn't give a shit about me. He may remember me because, you know, I had a following back then and I broke a lot of his artists. And I played fucking Don Henley's music when nobody did. You know, he did that shitty solo album, which is when I interviewed him. He couldn't get airplay on any other station in L.A. I played him. And this is how I get paid back. Thank you so much.
Well, as long as we're talking about the Eagles, tell me something that I should know about. Oh, I think he died. Glenn Frey, was that his
name? Glenn Frey died. Glenn Frey, you know, I met him once years earlier I think it might have even, well, it might have been after the Miami Vice days. Yeah, and Glenn Frey was a nice guy, from what I remember. Yeah. Don Henley was the jerk.
I actually asked because I kind of liked him. I used to watch, I loved Miami Vice back when it was live.
Yeah, I remember that. Fashion. We're old.
And he was great on it. Mm-hmm. He was great.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah. So he's dead, and of course, the Eagles, which only reunited again for the money, you notice a theme here? When they reunited, it was the Hell Freezes Over album and tour, because they had famously said, when asked, when is the Eagles going to reunite? When Hell Freezes Over. So when they called it the Hell Freezes Over tour. It's all about the money. And so when Glenn Frey died, they brought in, I don't know who they brought in, his son or some, who knows, but they're still touring as the Eagles. I'm sorry, without Glenn Frey, it's not the Eagles. It's Don Henley and
That was Joe Walsh. I was thinking. That's why I brought it up.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So, Harvey J.K., I got to ask you, we've only spoken one time since, and just so you know, I'm keeping an eye on the trial, and it's still this smarmy defense attorney who I have no interest in listening to. But if you want to listen to that, go on over to C-SPAN because it's still running.
They may be playing Glenn Frey and the Eagles over there.
Yeah, no, I don't think so.
What's his name? You mentioned originally, I forgot already.
Don Henley.
Yeah, Don Henley. Geez.
Kick them when they're up, kick them when they're down, kick them when they're up, kick them all around. Sorry. what was I saying? I did get so
know.
Distracted. No, so
we've only spoken once.
I know. So we spoke once, right? And it was right after, you know, Biden came into office, and I was like, I'm in a honeymoon period here. I'm not going to jump all over his shit. So now, Harvey J.K., we're 2 months into Joe Biden's administration.
Yeah.
And as I said, and you may disagree with me, but I am so happy to be wrong. I, like you, railed against Joe Biden. First of all, I thought there's no way this guy's going to win because he's ancient. He's a throwback to the, you know, 30 some odd years he spent in the Senate. And he has always governed. He has always legislated from the center or the center right. And that's not what we needed. What we needed was a bold progressive. Well, the Joe Biden we're seeing right now may not be incredibly bold, but he's certainly showing his progressive chops. He is doing things that I never, ever thought I'd see, starting with the ARP, the American Rescue Plan, which is bigger and better than I ever thought he would push through. It didn't have everything we wanted, but according to him, we're not done yet.
You want me to respond?
Yes,
now,
I want you to respond now. And you can be honest. Don't mince words.
Well, here's the thing. I remember thinking that he could conceivably go bolder than I expect, because right now we're in a crisis, an unprecedented crisis.
True.
But it's a, and I think I may have even said this to you, it was a crisis upon a crisis upon a crisis. So after 45 years of what I definitely call class war from above on working people, as well as the war on women's bodies, to be very specific about it, as well as the war on voting rights, most especially African-American voting rights, but equally the poor white and black and young people, university students. Mm-hmm. There was, after 45 years of all of that, to have a Trump administration for 4 years that could care less about the numbers of victims of the pandemic, not to mention a host of other things, such as that massive tax giveaway to corporate interests and the rich,
right?
You know, all that stuff. Then to have the pandemic strike, I mean, it was extraordinary. So I figured there would have to be some bold moves. The American Rescue Plan is probably larger than I would have imagined Joe Biden and the Democrats going.
Yep.
Though I can also tell you, I'm definitely not as enthusiastic yet as you are.
Okay.
And the reason is, well, first of all, I think it was so telling that the six Democrats could not buy a $15 minimum wage.
Yeah, well, that's a Chuck Schumer problem.
Trivial,
no, that's not trivial. $15
minimum wage is still poverty wages.
Yes.
Okay.
That is true.
So it's striking that Biden couldn't figure out a way to make it happen. And not to forget, what's the name of, is it Chris Coons? What's the guy's name from
Chris Coons,
Delaware?
And oh God, yes. What's the other guy? Both of the ones from Delaware, Coons,
right,
and
Delaware
Carper.
Senators, and
Carper.
Biden couldn't twist their arms.
Right, that, Coons and Carper, okay. And then the two from New Hampshire, Jean Shaheen and
oh,
Maggie
yeah.
Hassan. Like, what the fuck? And
you know,
then you got
ago,
Joe Manchin and Kyrsten Sinema. But so you got six of them. Yeah.
Yeah, right. Well, but it's funny, it's tragic almost. Years ago, when my daughter was an undergraduate, her first year at Harvard, Shaheen was running for something in New Hampshire. I mean, she's a political.
She was governor, I believe. She was governor before.
And she went door to door with Shaheen. And when she saw how Shaheen voted, she regretted these 20 years later, she regretted ever having supported her to begin with. But in any case, the point is that it was a telling thing about the Democrats that they couldn't get the $15 minimum wage inside of that. And then the question for me became whether or not Biden would find, or even Schumer, because Schumer, for all of Schumer's faults, and we don't have to go into those right now.
No, we don't.
The fact is, he does want to get reelected. He doesn't want to be primaried. We know all of that. That would they figure out a way to find to get the $15 included in a later?
Yeah, I believe they
reconciliation
will. I believe they will.
If they could work it out. The only thing is that this. So here's the thing. So we've got the first stage, and if I haven't said it to you in the past when I've talked about FDR, there are really four features of FDR's New Deal.
Yes.
The first one was relief, which is in this instance the rescue plan.
Right.
Then the other three are reconstruction, which is basically infrastructure in diverse ways.
Which is next.
Reform, which is in the 30s case, was both Social Security and the National Labor Relations Act.
Okay.
And last but not least is recovery, which is a part of every one of those other
three.
Right.
And I should say reform should come by the way of the For the People Act.
Yes, well, and the PRO Act.
You've and got the PRO
two,
Act.
Right, two
right.
key bills
yep.
that are there. Okay,
exactly.
So here's the thing. So right now, the question in my mind is, and people in the media, you know, the media, the mainstream media is even more enthusiastic than you are about Joe Biden.
I know.
I don't think I've ever heard you as enthusiastic
but
as
I've
you
are. I've never been. And you know, I'm part of a big, you know, a mailing list of real progressive people. I mean, these are lefties. And, you know, after Biden's press conference the other night, we were all sort of like, holy shit. It's, you know, it's good. I've never felt so good being wrong before.
Yeah, no, I'm not ready yet. Okay, let me put it this way. Because we are really right now, it's like we're right on the edge of a, what do they call it, like a knife, a pin or whatever.
Right.
We're right at the point where it's going to go one way
or the other.
Or it's going to go
right.
the other way.
Yep.
And if it goes, let's start off with the good first or the bad first. The good way is this, right? The good way is this, that this next step, the step we'll call the beginning of the reconstruction initiatives.
Okay.
Which, by the way, he's asking for too little to make those truly significant.
In the infrastructure thing, which is going to be like $3 to $4 trillion.
Well, it's not actually. If you look closely, it's not actually.
You're right.
Part of that's going back into the idea of rescue.
Right. Gotcha.
Stuff.
Yep.
No,
it's not all for roads and bridges.
It's got to be $4 trillion for infrastructure. Mm. I mean, it is a big country with expensive stuff. So it's going to have to be bigger. But in any case, let's suppose it moves ahead. And let's also not forget that these things won't be an overnight expenditure in all cases. He could go for $10 trillion and do $1 trillion a year.
Right, for 10 years.
Say.
Right.
Okay. But what I'm getting at is that's fundamental and essential, undeniably so. Okay. But here's the thing. What I want to see is whether or not he is willing to do what needs doing in association with it. And that means a certain set of executive orders.
Okay.
First executive order is a $15 minimum wage for anyone involved in the reconstruction effort, whether they're on a public or private contract, they get $15 an hour.
I don't know that he can do that. Maybe on public works, on government plans, but he can't sign an executive order to tell.
Yes, he can. I'll tell you why.
Okay.
Yes, he can. Because if they're receiving a federal contract, they're subject to an executive order.
If it's a federal contract. Got it.
Federal contract.
Yep.
That's one.
Okay.
The second thing is, collective bargaining rights.
Yes.
He can issue an executive order in the same way. Okay. And third, and by the way, this is what will matter to most people in their imaginations. He can actually demand that healthcare coverage be included in anyone who is working on the reconstruction effort.
Ah,
so that would be a sort of backdoor way to make those things happen that the Democrats are not willing to do.
Right. And it's not all the Democrats.
I'm talking about the Democrats.
Right. I know. And again, it is a small contingent of who I call conservadems, or Howie Klein calls the Republican wing of the Democratic Party. Right. And they're out there. And the fact of the matter is we need to deal with them in some way. This is where Joe Biden needs to use his relationships with the other senators, because he was one of them for so long, and get shit done. He needs to take those six aside.
On the bright side of that.
Yeah. Go ahead.
On the bright side of that, the one thing that Manchin always said he would go big on, he actually used the figure $4 trillion just for infrastructure weeks ago. So it's possible that, in fact, the Democrats can get it together. It's going to be whether or not they each get their piece of the pie for their states, whether or not there's some kind of there are a whole range of things. But if they're good negotiators out of the White House, they can make it happen. And by the way, I mean, I also want to say that I don't even believe for a moment any of this would have happened if it were not for Bernie Sanders.
Without a doubt, Bernie is the catalyst behind the progressive change. And because he is the chair of the Senate Budget Committee, we can sing it. He has the power. And you know that this is happening. And I must believe that when it came down to that Super Tuesday and Jim Clyburn saying, you know, screw Bernie Sanders, everybody get out so we can, you know, that Bernie and Joe had a little come to Jesus meeting and, you know, and said either we're going to work together or we're not. It'll be a lot easier if we work together. But by working together, it means you need to come over to our side a bit. And I really believe that's what happened.
Okay. Now, so that's the good start.
Okay.
Now, there's the middle range thing. Yeah. The middle range thing. If he's going to, I'll continue in the first place. If he wants to be FDR, that's what he talked about. He said FDR.
Yes, he did. Okay,
then he really does need to figure out what it will take to buy off the hesitant Dems to make, they're going to have to get rid of the filibusters.
To get rid of the filibuster. But here's the thing. They're bringing earmarks back. And that's how you buy off Joe Manchin.
Of course.
And
I'm with you.
Right?
That's right.
They can do it. He's like, okay, you want whatever for Appalachia. You want whatever for Arizona. You want whatever for New Hampshire and Delaware. We'll get that done, but you need to play ball with us.
Right. And then you got to, what they need, they kill the filibuster, they pass the PRO Act, the For the People Act, and seriously, seriously move in favor of statehood for D.C.
Without a doubt. And Puerto Rico.
Well, I don't say Puerto Rico only because it's not for me to say Puerto Rico. It's for the folks in Puerto Rico to say Puerto Rico.
If they want it, but we need to give them the opportunity because this is ridiculous. I'm sorry.
Yeah. That's the good stuff and the possible stuff.
Okay. Now the bad stuff.
Downside.
Okay.
But even the downside is not the worst thing, although it would piss me off.
The
downside is that they get the infrastructure bill through. That Biden does not issue the executive orders.
Right.
And in essence, so he's not FDR.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
He's not even LBJ. Okay. But the key thing is, at least he might be, don't laugh, Eisenhower.
A warning about the military-industrial complex?
I worry about the fact that Biden would never challenge them too much. No, the bigger thing is that it's Eisenhower who took the Roosevelt administration idea and signed the creation of the interstate highway system. The biggest singular infrastructure project in American history, I'm pretty sure, but I could be wrong, but I'm not talking about overall from an administration, but I mean a singular project,
right,
in the interstate highway system.
Gotcha.
So if they can get it, if Biden pushes through a massive infrastructure plan that, you know, really does address not only the renovation of our infrastructure, but extends high speed rail, say.
Right.
then we could possibly see at least an Eisenhower administration. I will remind everyone that Eisenhower himself, though a conservative, was not a conservative at all like those who came in the 70s, the 80s, the 90s, and today. He was conservative in the sense that even the Democrats would have been willing to run him for president in 1952.
Right, okay? Right. Yeah. Well, I don't know if you saw the show. You know, I do a graphic each day for the show. I'll put it up on the screen. This was today's. So there's LBJ, there's FDR, and there's Joe, J-R-B. But Joe is easier. You know, Joe.
Come on, man.
So, yeah. Anyway, those are, you know, the LBJ is the most progressive. Was the most progressive president in my lifetime. I want to see Joe Biden take that mantle. Yes, domestic policy. I mean, Vietnam is, you know, Vietnam.
It's really a shame, actually, because...
It really is.
I mean, it's a tragedy, not only for the lives lost, which are huge, but during Vietnam, but also the fact that he really was moving in such a remarkably New Deal-like way. I mean, if I could just tell the audience...
Please.
It isn't civil rights, voting rights acts... It's Medicare, Medicaid, yes. Immigration reform, environmental laws. I mean, it laid out an incredible array of progressive moves. He really did want to be the new FDR. He wanted to complete the New Deal. That was the Great Society.
Yes. And that's and he knew how to get shit done. That's the thing. Yeah. He'd call someone up sitting on the toilet with his big Johnson hanging out and say, "You will do this. And if you don't do this, I'm going to fuck you up." He got shit done. Joe Biden needs to take a book out of LBJ's a page out of LBJ's book.
Yeah, I've been friends for some years with Bill Moyers, who was his press secretary,
right?
And Bill always said that he was a big guy, Johnson, and he could look, even if he wasn't, he could always look down on you in some way. Uh-huh. He could literally seem to be about to break your arm off if you weren't willing to go in his direction. I mean, he knew how to make things. Well, he wasn't just in the Senate as Biden had been. He was also the master of the Senate.
Oh, right.
I mean, he really was the man in charge of the Senate for so many years in the 50s. And by the way, I mean, people always underestimated him for all of his faults and failings. And ultimately, it was a tragic administration. The fact was that he was more committed to the sort of classical FDR liberalism than people realized. Mm-hmm. In fact, in the Kennedy years, the Kennedy administration... It was nothing compared to the LBJ administration. No. That everyone should realize that.
No, and Kennedy is made to be, the golden boy, and he was the... No, LBJ was the great progressive. Sorry, maybe JFK could have gotten stuff done if he hadn't been killed, but, he's not the guy who got all this done. It was Johnson.
Right. Yeah, after World War II, when Kennedy came home, and his father's money was determined to propel him into Massachusetts politics... Kennedy made it clear to people that he would say, "I am not a liberal." Uh-huh. Period. And that was his line. I am not a liberal.
Right.
And in fact, the Kennedy family was in many ways a fairly pretty reactionary family. I mean, they were anti-Semites. They were close to McCarthy. The whole thing.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
But they thought Johnson was a nothing. They really thought he was a marginal figure. And in 1963, before the assassination, apparently they assigned Johnson the job of going to Gettysburg to give a speech in honor of the 100th anniversary of the Gettysburg Address.
Okay.
And apparently the speech he gave, I read it some years ago, the speech was like this really progressive speech, projecting civil rights. And I mean, Johnson was ready. On civil rights, he was ready to move. Back in the 50s, there were civil rights bills that were passed, and they always got watered down for the Senate to pass them. But the fact is, if LBJ had wanted to block them, he could have, but he never did. And in fact, I think King himself acknowledged that even the passage of those bills, however watered down they were, meant that things were going to change.
Mm-hmm.
They were coming, which really sort of helped empower civil rights movement in the 60s. I mean, you know, those were different days, of course.
Yeah, they were. And you know, look, I was so young during that time, and you're, I think, only a year older than me. But, but there's lots of history books, and there are movies about that time. Watch them. LBJ is, you know, he doesn't get the credit that he deserves, and obviously it's because of Vietnam, because that, Vietnam was his, you know,
And I reject the Oliver Stone implications that LBJ was somehow
responsible for JFK's murder.
Right.
Oliver Stone. Yeah,
exactly.
No,
exactly.
I don't believe that either. So, you know, he deserves a lot more credit for getting us where we are. And Joe Biden should be turned in his direction to say, follow Johnson's lead. He knew how to get us there. Hold on one second, Harvey. Yeah. We got to say goodbye to the Progressive Voices Network. Bye. I'll see you tomorrow, everyone. Thanks for listening.
Good. Okay.
All right. Well, so now we're still on. Progressive Voices has left us. So Harvey J.K. is still with me, and we're in overtime now. So, yeah. So I think the potential, though, is there. And I think he wants to make it happen, right?
I didn't scoff at anything you said.
Right.
I just worry that we're at this moment where hit the real test of his ability to be an LBJ, in this sense, to be an LBJ. Because one thing that FDR had was he had control of Congress, except on civil rights type questions. The Southern Democrats were really eager to block that.
Mm-hmm.
But in LBJ's case, he knew also he could pull away some liberal Republicans, which Biden, there are no such things as liberal Republicans. They don't exist.
Today, in 2021, they don't. In 1964, they did. They don't now, right?
But the real thing is, but the test will be, does Biden have it in him, not so much to reach across the aisle? Can he reach into the room of his own party?
Those six. Well, yeah. I think he can. Let's go to the press. Do you have a few minutes to hang?
Okay,
cool. So the press conference that happened on Thursday, I want to play Joe Biden's answer on the filibuster. Because while none of those journalists asked about COVID, which I think is just a travesty, and Caitlin Collins of CNN should be ashamed of herself for the bullshit question about, running in 4 years and will Kamala Harris be your running mate?
I actually tweeted, I said, CNN should not be allowed. You know how Trump wanted to ban them from press conferences. Biden has more reason to ban them, perhaps.
No kidding. Oh my God. And I thought she was decent at her job until that moment. Anyway,
everyone thought that. Yeah.
Right. Unbelievable. Just how fucking stupid can you be? Here's the question on the filibuster, though.
For example, it used to be you had to stand there and talk and talk and talk and talk until you collapsed. And guess what? People got tired of talking and tired of collapsing. The filibusters broke down and we were able to break the filibuster, get a quorum and vote. So I strongly support moving in that direction. In addition to having an open mind about dealing with certain things that are just elemental to the functioning of our democracy, like the right to vote. Like the basic right to vote. We've amended the filibuster in the past. But here's the deal. As you observed, I'm a fairly practical guy. I want to get things done. I want to get them done consistent with what we promised the American people.
Okay.
And in order to do that, in a 50-50 Senate, we've got to get to the place where I get 50 votes so that the Vice President of the United States can break the tie, or I get 51 votes without her. And so I'm going to say something outrageous. I have never been particularly poor at calculating how to get things done in the United States Senate. So the best way to get something done, if it holds near and dear to you that you like to be able to, anyway.
That's where he fucks himself up.
We're going to get a lot done. And if we have to, if there's complete lockdown and chaos as a consequence of the filibuster, then we'll have to go beyond what I'm talking about.
So he tripped himself up on his own words.
There was one time where he ran out of steam, and I thought, oh, God, and it was early on. And I mean, I do worry about the obvious. So.
Yeah, but you know what? He's always been that way. And this is the thing that, you know, this White House has not been good enough about that messaging. Joe Biden has always been the gaffe machine. He's always had trouble with his words. He's always talked too much or said, you know, the reason that Obama so early came out for same-sex marriage is because Joe Biden jumped the gun on him. So Obama had no choice because he went on a Sunday show and said, oh, I'm all for marriage equality. It was like a year ahead of schedule or something.
It's clear that he's definitely willing to go somewhere to make the filibuster less of a hurdle.
Right.
A burden, not an obstruction. The question is he willing to get angry one night and tell the American people, I've had it. Democracy is at stake. We're going to kill the filibuster.
But okay. I think he's trying to do it in a way to try to, you know, to finesse, to massage the situation and get Manchin and Sinema and whoever else might not be on board. I think these things take time. Just like, I was pissed off the $15 an hour minimum wage didn't make it into the ARP bill. But I don't think it's dead. I believe they're going to get it done another way. We're 65 days or whatever into this administration.
70.
Okay. Take a breath and let's give them the space to get it done. So far, he's done okay, which to me is something I never in a million years thought I'd ever say.
I never thought I'd hear you say it.
I never thought I'd say it. So I'm giving him the benefit of the doubt here. I'm of the mind, so far, so good. Let him keep going. So far, he's impressed me. I'm willing to stand back and go, okay, show me what else you got. You want to be FDR? You want to be LBJ? Do it. Prove it. Well, and I think he wants to. He wants a legacy.
I'm more angry with the likes of the Washington Post and New York Times columnists who are trying to say he's already become FDR.
No.
And so as a consequence, I get impatient with them and I look at him and I say, don't let this go to your head unless you use it as some kind of rejuvenation every day to make it really true.
Fountain of youth. Yeah, I know. See, I worry about him when he starts talking and he got the old person's cough. I know the old person's cough because I had an older father and, you know, and it coughs up shit. And then, you know, that he's got the gunk in his throat and he's going to swallow it. He can't turn around and spit it out. This is the kind of shit that goes through my mind because he's an old man, but he swallows it. So,
That's great.
He moves That's right really along. Sorry, I hope you're not eating dinner because that was gross.
In about five minutes, I am.
And while you're chewing, you'll think of...
Yeah, that's really good. That's really good. Oh, Jesus, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, but, you know, still, I'd rather have that than, you know...
No, clearly. But you know what? I can't be patient because
I know
he's got to make sure these things happen before 2020.
I agree.
Sorry, 2022.
2022. And there were a lot of fuck ups, you know, in the fact that the Senate is 50-50. The fact that the House has like a 4-seat difference. What are you kidding me?
Okay,
that should not have happened.
Think about this. The state of Vermont has two great senators, Leahy and Sanders, and both are older
than Joe Biden. And if either one of them, something horrible should happen, the governor is a Republican.
Right.
There it goes. And Joe Manchin, as much as I want to go tell him to go pound wood or whatever the expression is, you can't because he could turn around and say, okay, I'll be a Republican.
Yeah, well, yeah.
And it wouldn't change anything on the voting, but what it would do is take the gavel from Chucky Schmucky and give it to Mitch McTurtle. Which is the last thing we want, ever.
Which is actually why, right now, Joe Biden has got to move a little more quickly than you're willing to allow.
Okay. Well,
because we've got to get
Get rid of the filibuster. We've got to deal with that. Yeah. And I hope he's doing things behind the scenes that we don't know about.
Yeah, like offering Manchin and Sinema great ambassadorships.
I don't think they're ready for that yet.
Manchin, but is there a Democratic governor in either one of those states?
No.
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 Oh, God.
No.
Well,
No, but
offering. Wait, they have a Democratic governor in Alaska now, no, right, they, or not?
I don't think so. I don't know.
Because I was thinking maybe somebody's got to be able to. How about Maine?
How about we win back there? Russ Feingold's seat from that moron? This is your state.
Geez, yeah.
What the fuck happened in Wisconsin, Harvey? Russ Feingold was one of the greatest progressives in the U.S. Senate, and this moron, what's his name? Ron Johnson, somehow unseated him, and he's getting more and more batshit crazy with each passing day.
Yeah, I actually don't get it, because everyone who's ever met him, and I haven't even met him, but I had students who did, knew he was an idiot.
Yeah.
They knew it, okay? But I didn't expect him to go all out racist, okay? Yeah. I didn't. That is...
He's nuts.
I mean, yeah, he is.
He's nuts. He went off the deep end. He jumped the literal shark. So is he running for re-election, or is he just saying, I'm going to bow out.
2022.
I think it's 2022.
I go through this once a week, and I confess I forget.
I think it's 2022. I think he's up.
Yeah. Geez, I hope so.
Geez, I hope so, too. And I wish Russ Feingold would run again.
By the way, the Democrats in the state are not a very, very exciting party at the higher level. So, I mean, we've got some really good young progressives now in the legislature, as you know. But folks who would be eligible to run for Senate, I don't know. I mean, the people they've put up in the last few times, I don't know.
How did Russ Feingold ever lose? He was so good.
To this day, I don't get it. Although it was the same, wasn't it?
It was 2010, I believe, wasn't
2010.
It? It was the wave.
I blame Obama then.
Yeah, I blame Obama too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In fact, one thing we'll agree after we say this.
Yes, okay.
One thing that Joe Biden is doing is kind of showing that Obama, people are going to see how utterly inadequate Obama was.
That's right. Well, okay. And showing that Joe Biden admits it and it wants to make up, wants to fix, take care of the mistakes that Obama did. For instance, the stimulus under Obama was way too small. That's why the ARP Act was big, because it needed to be. He learned from Obama's mistakes, which is the most you can ask for any politician.
That's right. That's right.
That's right.
That's fair. Absolutely.
Harvey J.K., I know you got to run. We need to do this more often.
I'm happy to. Happy to. Just ask. I'll be back.
Now that you're emeritus, you're home.
Emeritus, right?
Have you?
Exactly.
Have you gotten shot yet?
I need someone to talk to.
Have you been inoculated yet? Have you
twice.
Been vaccinated?
I'm ready.
You're done. I got my second shot, too. I'm in my 14-day period. April 7th.
Great.
April 7th, I'm ready for hugs. So... All right.
I'll give them virtually, you bet.
Yes. Thank you so much. Harvey J.K., talk to you soon.
Bye-bye.
All right. And with that, everybody, we are done. Oh, I need to get out of this screen, or we're going to have this Citizen Kane effect going on forever. Come on. I'm just going to go. I'm going to leave you with the what's news, because I can. Thank you for listening. We'll do it again tomorrow. Tomorrow, I'm going to be speaking with Robin Bartleman. She is a Florida legislator. The Florida legislative session is going on now. I've known Robin for years. She was a school board member. I first met her when she was out giving out flyers running for school board for the first time when I just moved back to Florida. It was like 2002 or 2004 or something like that. Anyway, she's up in Tallahassee now. And so we'll talk tomorrow. And of course, we've got that trial still going on. In case you were wondering, they did break. They're done. I guess they're done for the day. They will be back tomorrow. And I was right. They ended after the defense attorney questioned the firefighter woman. So that's that. We'll pick it up tomorrow where we left off. And I will leave you with the news, because I can. Thanks for listening, everyone. See you tomorrow. Take care. Good luck to us all. Everyone.
I read the news today, oh boy.
It's time for Nicole Sandler's What's News from NicoleSandler.com and the Progressive Voices Network.
The murder trial of the former Minneapolis cop who the world saw kill George Floyd last May on video began Monday with opening statements and even the first few witnesses on the stand. Special Assistant Attorney General Jerry Blackwell was up first for the prosecution. He said that the former cop, Derek Chauvin, betrayed his badge and his oath to avoid unnecessary force when he pressed his knee into George Floyd's neck for 9 minutes last year. He explained that Chauvin was told twice that Floyd, an unarmed black man who died in custody, did not have a pulse, but the officer, quote, didn't let up.
You will learn that on May 25th of 2020, Mr. Derek Chauvin betrayed this badge when he used excessive and unreasonable force upon the body of Mr. George Floyd. That he put his knees upon his neck and his back, grinding and crushing him until the very breath, no, ladies and gentlemen, until the very life was squeezed out of him. That Mr. Floyd was in handcuffs. He was completely in the control of the police. He was defenseless. You will learn what happened in that 9 minutes and 29 seconds, the most important numbers you will hear in this trial at 9:29. What happened in those 9 minutes and 29 seconds when Mr. Derek Chauvin was applying this excessive force to the body of Mr. George Floyd?
Defense attorney Eric Nelson delivered their opening statement, basically saying that Chauvin was doing what he was trained to do.
This case is clearly more than about 9 minutes and 29 seconds. And you will learn that Derek Chauvin did exactly what he had been trained to do over the course of his 19-year career. The use of force is not attractive, but it is a necessary component of policing.
The prosecution's first witness was 911 dispatcher Jenna Scurry. She said she watched surveillance video and noticed that Chauvin kept Floyd pinned to the street for so long, she thought her video feed was frozen, and she knew something was not right. The trial continues Tuesday and will likely last at least a few weeks. Moving on to COVID, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention director, Dr. Rochelle Walensky, said during her Monday press briefing that she has a recurring feeling of, quote, impending doom with new coronavirus cases rising recently after a sharp decline. She urged people to continue avoiding unnecessary travel and got a bit emotional. She said, I so badly want to be done. I know you all so badly want to be done. We're just about there, but not quite yet. Walensky pointed to Germany, France, and Italy, where cases have spiked over the last few weeks, noting that the trajectory here in the U.S., quote, looks similar. She did suggest that there's plenty of room for optimism, though, noting that vaccines are being rolled out, quote, so very fast. And then President Biden weighed in with a plea.
As I do my part to accelerate the vaccine distribution and vaccinations, I need the American people to do their part as well. Mask up. Mask up. It's a patriotic duty. It's the only way we ever get back to normal.
Mask up. And good news, we got some details Monday from a new study by researchers at the CDC that show that the Moderna and Pfizer coronavirus vaccines have been highly effective at preventing infections in real-world conditions. They say by 2 weeks after the second dose, the vaccines prevented 90% of symptomatic and asymptomatic infections. By 2 weeks after the first dose, they prevented 80% of infections. The report was consistent with data from the clinical trials, and the results suggested that transmission was rare among vaccinated people, something that scientists had long debated. Get your vaccine. Well, they say the waiting is the hardest part. And now Amazon warehouse workers in Alabama have wrapped up the most closely watched union election in decades. Counting is now underway to determine whether the retail, wholesale, and department store union will represent the nearly 6,000 Amazon workers there in Alabama. But it could be days or weeks before we know the results. Stay tuned. The Biden administration on Monday said plans to designate an area between New Jersey and New York a priority offshore wind zone, part of a plan to accelerate wind projects in the Atlantic under Biden's push to curb greenhouse gas emissions. The administration said it was taking the first steps towards signing off on a massive wind farm off the New Jersey coast as part of a push to produce enough electricity to power more than 10 million homes by 2030. Sounds good to me. Not only would meeting the goal avoid 78 million metric tons of carbon dioxide emissions per year, it would also create 44,000 jobs and indirectly lead to the addition of another 33,000. The plan also promises $3 billion in federal loan guarantees for offshore wind projects. Shipping traffic resumed in Egypt's Suez Canal on Monday after tugboats managed to refloat the massive container ship, the Ever Given, which had been wedged across the waterway, blocking it for nearly a week. The chair of the Suez Canal Authority said it would probably take more than 3 days or so to clear a backlog of 422 ships waiting to pass through the canal. Wednesday is Infrastructure Day, but this time it really is. President Biden will lay out the first of a sweeping two-pronged infrastructure and jobs proposal on Wednesday. It'll likely cost between $3 and $4 trillion, but it will include things like badly needed repairs for the country's physical infrastructure. Meanwhile, the White House will host a bipartisan briefing for House members on Wednesday to discuss the worsening situation at the U.S.-Mexico border. The administration is struggling to find space to house the record number of unaccompanied minors and has even asked federal workers to volunteer at facilities to house and care for the children. Well, Georgia's new controversial and restrictive voting law has faced a lot of backlash. Two federal lawsuits have been filed to challenge the law, one brought by a Democratic election attorney on behalf of racial justice groups, another by a collective of several civil rights and voting rights groups. The lawsuits allege the new laws, which do things like limit ballot drop boxes and make it illegal to give water to those waiting in line to vote, are unconstitutional and violate the Voting Rights Act. Justice groups are urging sports organizations like the PGA Tour and Major League Baseball to reconsider holding upcoming major events in the state of Georgia. And that's just a bit of what's news for now. I'm Nicole Sandler. If you appreciate these reports and the Nicole Sandler Show, I hope you'll consider making a contribution. My work is 100% listener supported, and I can't do it without your help. Find out more at NicoleSandler.com, and please click on that donate button.